news for you. Sources telling CNN that President Trump's lawyers are trying to limit the questions Robert Mueller might ask the president in an interview. They want the special counsel to agree not to question Trump about, wait for this, anything he's done in office, which doesn't seem or even sound like a deal that Mueller would take, since it would mean not asking the president about the firing of James Comey and possible obstruction of justice. And it comes as the president doubles down on his unproven claims that he's a victim of the so-called deep state conspiracy, repeating his suggestion of spies in his campaign, even though there is no evidence of that. And officials have told CNN there was no such source planted inside the Trump campaign. And we have more breaking news for you tonight. CNN projects Stacey Abrams will win the Democratic primary in Georgia's gubernatorial race. She now has a chance to become the nation's first black female governor. We're going to have more on that in just a moment. But I want to bring in CNN senior economics analyst Stephen Moore, who is a senior advisor to the Trump campaign. Also, CNN political commentator Amanda Carpenter and the author of Gaslighting America, Why We Love It When Trump Lies to Us, and national security attorney Mark Zaid and CNN contributor Frank Bruni of The New York Times. Frank, you should have joined us here in Washington. We would love to have had you on set with us. So since you're not here, I'm going to start with Mark. Good evening. So, Mark, sources are telling CNN that Trump's legal team, the team is trying to limit the scope and that they don't want them to ask him about anything that took place after he took office, which means the firing of Michael Flynn and James Comey. Nothing about obstruction of justice. Do you think, is this something that Mueller is likely to agree to?
No, I can't imagine that he would. I mean, it makes perfect sense for the Trump lawyers to try and do so. Anytime that we're handling these types of cases, that would make the most perfect sense. But there's no way, given what the scope of the investigation has been and has broadened into from what we understand it to be, that he could eliminate, meaning Mueller could agree to eliminate that type of scope of questioning. And we can talk about probably length of time, perhaps, maybe going somewhat off on some tangents, but there's enough in the sense of limiting it, but there's enough that's out there so far that brings into play financial transactions, especially with the indictment of Manafort on bank fraud issues and money laundering type issues that are all tied together that will go back in time. So he'll never agree to it.
Frank, I'm wondering, listen, the Mueller and his team have been airtight, and I'm wondering if the Trump team, if they're taking advantage of it, because we have repeatedly seen the team try to negotiate with the special counsel through the media. But Robert, I mean, obviously Mueller cannot respond. It would not be in his best interest or the country's interest to respond. Is this how the president and his team try to create a new reality to sell to the American people, where they their side is the only side that we hear about?
Well, yeah, I think they're taking advantage of the fact that they know the other side isn't going to talk. And, you know, some of this is substantive. Much of this is substantive. It's about getting at the truth, and that's Mueller's principal aim. But there's another dimension here, which is the dimension of public relations. And I think Donald Trump and the people around him, especially since Giuliani came on board, and Giuliani, in his erratic way, they're trying harder than ever to project to the public that they're talking, they're negotiating, they're trying to be reasonable, they are giving terms under which they're willing to cooperate. And they know they have our attention and our ear, and the other side isn't talking. And I think, yes, they're trying to use that very much to their advantage.
Steve, here's what the president said today. Watch this.
If they had spies in my campaign, that would be a disgrace to this country. That would be one of the biggest insults that anyone's ever seen, and it would be very illegal. Aside from everything else, if they had spies in my campaign, during my campaign for political purposes, that would be unprecedented in the history of our country.
So he is demanding an investigation into the investigation in which he is involved in. Isn't that what's really unprecedented here?
No, look, I agree with everything that Donald Trump just said there, that if there is evidence, and you said last night there is no evidence, we'll find out about that. If there is evidence that the FBI was investigating his campaign, then this is a much bigger scandal than the Russia investigation, because it suggests that you've got a Justice Department of one administration and one party that's interfering in an election and trying to undermine that election. So I think this is more serious than the Russia.
You're daring to get in here.
No, I'm just, those are pretty big ifs.
Right.
Yes,
well,
if all that happened, it would be a big deal. And so, yeah, we're going to have the Inspector General look into it. Fine. I think that's a pretty easy ask. The second part of the president's ask this week, and having the Intelligence Committee turn over sensitive material to Republicans in Congress, is pretty worrisome. I don't understand how you don't invite the Democrats to also get that information. And since we have someone that specializes in this kind of law, what happens if that information leaks? What's the exposure to the people that leak that much mail? Because I don't think for a second that's not going to get out.
And by the way, let me remind everyone that Amanda is a Republican.
Yes. Right?
So yes. I think that's important to say.
Look, the worst case is someone can be killed when you have, whether I've represented spies, that's what I do for a living. I represent informants for the U.S. government. I've represented agents, which are the ones that we hire overseas. And when their identities get out, they could potentially lose their lives, or their families could lose their lives. But in this particular case, if it is this individual American who is over in England, doubtful that's what's going to happen to him. But what kind of message does it send to others who we want to have work for the U.S. government, whether here in the United States or even state and local governments, when we can't protect our, whether it's informants, spies, assets, agents, whatever you want to call them, what this shows as an example is a really bad one. And biggest problem when anything goes to Congress, we all know, is more likely than not, it leaks out.
To me, the interesting thing that I mentioned this last night is that there was such a fuss about the potential unmasking of Americans' names. And then this is very similar. They're asking for a very similar, I guess you agree with me, Frank. They're asking to really reveal the name, or they actually did reveal the name of someone who is a source. What's the difference here?
You're just noting certain inconsistencies, Don, and those are prevalent in the Trump administration. But I also want to say that bite you played of Donald Trump, where he talked about spies in the campaign, this is classic Trump, where we know that a longtime informant talked to people in the campaign. It's an enormous leap in exaggeration to go from that to be talking about multiple spies embedded in the campaign. And this is the kind of disinformation that Donald Trump is so good at because he's so shameless about it. He's willing to take a tiny morsel and to make an entire buffet out of it, a buffet of half-truths and, in some cases, outright lies.
So here's, Amanda, this is Jake Tapper is reporting that Trump allies, Steve Bannon, Corey Lewandowski, Dave Bossi, and Steve Cortez, they want him to attack Rod Rosenstein as part of the so-called deep state. And here's what Lewandowski and Bossi said on Fox News tonight after leaving a meeting at the White House. Watch this.
If there was a spy place on the Trump campaign, there had better become accountability. Somebody had better be walked out in handcuffs, because it is the most egregious, most disgusting thing that our country as a democracy has ever seen. And if that's been done by a government official with their knowledge or their tacit knowledge, then that person better be walked out in handcuffs as well.
It's an outrage. This president should be, I believe he is very upset about this, and I am very upset about it. I know that all of us that worked on this campaign and worked hard for our candidate to think that the United States government was spying on us is outrageous.
Jake reported this yesterday, and voila.
I give an A plus for
there you go. So your book is about gaslighting, and this is why Donald Trump, the president, is so effective at gaslighting and completely reinforcing. His allies are constantly reinforcing his message, even though, again, under false premises.
Yeah, it's like whether you look up, is the sky blue or green? If you, I think, are a rational person, you can look at this investigation and say, wow, there's a lot of coincidences here. There's a lot of undisclosed contacts between the Trump campaign and Russian officials, a lot of lies. Or if you're seeing it through the Trumpian lens, you think the sky is green and you think this is evidence of entrapment and a secret coup by the deep state to unseat a president they always hated. So you have these competing narratives, which one is completely unhinged, not based in reality, and now they have, you know, paid operatives who are going to go in the media and continue to blanket the airwaves with it.
Well, let me respond to that. Look, you all are making the case that, gee, you know, there's nobody in the Obama administration that would possibly, you know, have engaged in this act of illegality. I mean, that would never happen.
That's not the case.
Here's the point. I mean, we know these kinds of things did happen. We know what happened with the IRS, where the IRS was under Obama was spying on conservative groups.
No, so that was a completely different. You're misrepresenting what happened there. I understand that scandal, and it was legitimate.
I'm not misrepresenting it.
They weren't spying on groups. They were not allowing people to get tax-exempt status.
Yeah, that's a pretty big deal.
That's not spying.
And they were using that.
Okay, Stephen, y'all, let's take it down a notch here. Let's take it down a notch, because no one listens when we're all talking over each other.
For political partisan purposes.
So just for facts, Those are two different things. No, that is not spying. So you're conflating two different things.
I'm saying that there was a pattern. There were examples.
One is not a pattern.
Okay. Well, it was a pretty egregious occasion, and to say, well, gee, that would never happen in the Justice Department. Well, it happened in the IRS.
Here's the facts of what happened during the Trump campaign. The Trump campaign was warned that there were Russians trying to infiltrate them or possibly spy on them, and yet they continued to have people associated with the campaign go into Moscow, go give speeches, run back and forth, try to arrange meetings between Trump and Putin. Why did that happen? Why did Don Jr. invite the Russians up
bad
to Trump Tower?
I actually think there's
a plausible explanation. Maybe they wanted to keep the business interests open in the event that they lost the election. They wanted to still build Trump Tower. But Donald Trump has offered nothing except for this crazy deep state conspiracy theory. So maybe they should start answering questions rather than floating out these wild ideas that are just not believable in any rational sense.
Mark, you want to say something?
Well, you know, if you look at even his tweets tonight, I always, when I see what he's doing, want to just remind him, you know, you're the president of the United States.
Let's put up the tweet as he talks about
you
that.
You could get these answers really easily without tweeting them out in this deep state conspiratorial fashion to energize the base. All he has to do is ask the FBI and the Justice Department to find out, well, what reporting was done, who signed off on this individual. You don't have to cater to the, regardless of what side, Democrats, Republicans, on the Hill, where there is encroaching upon Justice Department, law enforcement, intelligence boundaries that no president, regardless of party, should want done to keep the branches separate, to protect the ability of these agencies to function. And instead of obtaining the information first, he then tweets. Now, an IG investigation, you know what? Every federal agency should have authority and exercise it to investigate whether its own personnel has broken the law. I don't have any issue with that. I represent people before inspector generals all the time. But all he had to do was ask the question privately first to find
out
if there was something there.
Hey, Frank, I haven't forgotten about you, because I'm going to ask you about your piece first. But just for the folks here in the room, and Steve, I'm going to give this to you. Because after the 2016 election, CBS correspondent Leslie Stahl met with Trump before their 60 Minutes interview, and he began to attack the media off camera. So she asked why he was still hammering the press after the election, and Stahl told this story to a room filled with reporters last night at a journalism event. Watch this.
He said, "You know why I do it? I do it to discredit you all and demean you all, so when you write negative stories about me, no one will believe you." Said that.
I don't even get the question. I mean, the media was 90% against Donald Trump. It was an avalanche of negativity against Trump. I was part of the campaign. It was not fair treatment. And
the media was not 90% against Donald Trump.
Absolutely. I mean, look, you're talking about
someone who wrote a story. That's not the point. Hold on. But
it was not
I spend my time, most of my time, as you know, right, Frank, trying to pull people back from the shiny objects and from the deflections. The media was not 90% against Donald Trump. You're talking about someone who did a poll saying that the coverage was 90% negative of Donald Trump. This president operates on a different level than anyone else. You can't expect to have the same level in this presidency of reporting as other presidencies, because he's unprecedented. He attacks the media. He says negative things all the time. He says outrageous things all the time. How do you put a positive spin on that?
That's right.
Because, I mean, let me answer that question. You know, we have the strongest economy in 25 years.
No.
You never report on that.
Again, that's a deflection. That's not true. We talked about that last night. We discussed that.
And you know, people say, well, Donald Trump doesn't deserve credit for the fact that we have.
And every time you come on, you give the same answer. You
say that it is the essence of what the election was about.
Because you're deflecting. Because you're deflecting.
It wasn't about Russia. It wasn't about, you know.
If someone calls countries s-holes, we say, oh, that's great. Should we say, oh, that's great, the president does it?
Where's the two sides on that one? Exactly.
Where's the other side? If someone says that there are fine people on both sides, oh, how do you spin that? Is that supposed to be positive?
Well, look,
if someone is rude to a gold star widow on a phone call, are we supposed to spin that in a positive manner?
My philosophy about Donald Trump is very simple. Yeah. Does he sometimes say completely outlandish?
Not sometimes.
Things? Absolutely, yes.
But you still didn't answer the question.
The key to this president is you have to look at his
results.
He
says outrageous things every day.
But you have to look at his results.
He says outrageous things.
They're off the charts in terms of the highest growth rate.
He says
the lowest unemployment rate.
He says and does outrageous things every day. He attacks institutions. He attacks norms.
He does
things
back
that's no. He doesn't. He doesn't attack back institutions. He's attacking institutions.
The media was against
He's
him.
He's undermining Donald, institutions.
Don, the media was against Donald Trump from the first day that he started.
He received an estimated billions of dollars of free coverage.
Actually,
from the campaign,
that's true.
And
he
says the media is fake and that it was negative.
Well, he did
certainly.
The,
he certainly
like
got
a
lot.
I'll give you
anyways,
that. I mean,
but you still didn't answer the question.
Which was
he admitted. That he does that because he wants to undermine the media. That is, again, attacking another institution.
He thinks the media has been completely unfair to him, and I think most Americans would agree with that.
Billions of dollars. Frank, I'll give you the last word.
No, the media.
I wanted to talk about your reporting, but
no, that's fine. The media coverage of Trump is flawed. It certainly is, and I wrote a whole column about this last weekend. But that's not the point of what Leslie Stahl just said there. What she said, and what we all know, is that Trump attacks the media just because if he can completely invalidate us, then any criticism we give of him, no one will hear. And that's exactly, by the way, what he's trying to do as well right now with the Mueller investigation. Same thing, different objects of attack.
Tweeting then meets the eye. It may not even be his tweeting. I want to talk about this with Annie Linsky, the national political reporter at the Boston Globe. Before we get started, we often read his tweets and say, I don't think he wrote that just from the way it is structured and written. So it appears from your reporting that his staff may be getting better
at
tweeting in his voice, correct?
Well, yeah. I've talked to some of his staff about this, and they've said that they sometimes do have a hard time knowing. Was it a Trump tweet or a staff suggestion tweet?
Right.
So they're getting better. And it's an interesting point because you think sometimes the staff is going to mold the president, and in this case, the president is definitely molding the staff.
Okay. So you say that the staff will oversee the exclamation point, or overuse, I should say, the exclamation point, capitalize random words to give a tweet the sort of Trumpian touch, you say. So I want to go through some of the more notable tweets that we have seen lately from Trump's Twitter account. First of all, one yesterday, the Wall Street Journal asks, where in the world was Barack Obama? And that's in all caps, right? A very good question. Who do you think wrote that? Was that a Trump or a staffer?
Well, you also want to look at the time stamp on that, too. That's another critical thing.
What was the time? I don't know if we saw the time on
the
that.
The time stamp, you know, if that's a sort of a non...
8:51 a.m.
8:51, so that's probably a Trump tweet.
Okay.
So the 9:30 to 10, you know, starting at 9:30 or 10 and going till 5 or 6 is when the staff drafted tweets tend to go out, even if they're in his voice. So you'll see him talk about, you know, went to an event and to honor our great vets with great and vets both capitalized.
Right.
And that's the type of thing that's typically probably a staff member.
Okay.
About.
How about this one? Let's do another one. The witch hunt finds no collusion with Russia. So now they're looking at the rest of the world. Oh, great.
Yeah. Well, the oh, great in there is a big giveaway.
And that's 1:13 p.m.
Yeah. Well, 1:13 p.m., yes. But the oh, great, with that little odd little apostrophe on there, it was particularly odd. That's the oh, great one, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. That one is a Trump tweet.
Was that giveaway of what?
That Trump did that one.
That it is Trump.
Because
it's
such an uncommon error that it's not one that they would be mimicking. Like, I haven't seen him do that before.
Okay.
And that means his staff hasn't seen it either. So that's sort of a new... error that he's inserting into his tweeting.
Okay. Despite the disgusting, illegal, and unwarranted witch hunt, we have had the most successful first 17-month administration in U.S. history by far. Sorry to the fake news media and haters, but that's the way it is.
I think that one's a little harder.
What time was it written?
What's the time stamp on that one?
9:52 a.m. It doesn't sound like him to me.
I could go either way on that one. Yeah.
Okay. And then you spoke with a professor who says that Trump's imprecise language plays into, this is a quote, the narrative that the coastal elites don't understand ordinary Americans who make typos. So he's just an ordinary American?
Well, I think he certainly wants us to believe that he's not a billionaire. He's not a New York elite. That he's has a common touch. And I think, you know, part of what happens here, too, is he likes the outrage. I mean, they like the idea that elites, so-called elites, are a little bit annoyed by his use of grammar and his imprecise use of grammar. I mean, we all make typos. I might make typos. I'm sure you do, too. But I mean, I strive not to. And I think what's different here is the staff is striving to do that.
But if I do that, I apologize and say I'm sorry. That was an error. But
right, you do.
most people do that. But he's a New York elite. He's the elite of
Went to an Ivy League school.
Went to Ivy League school and lives at the top of a tower.
Right.
But okay, so listen, there's a process.
Yes.
That these tweets go through.
Yes.
At the White House.
Yes, I was really intrigued by this too. It's sort of when a staff member has an idea or a topic that they want tweeted about. So let's just say Veterans Affairs. There's a veterans bill moving or a farm bill moving through Congress. The staff member will come up with a list of maybe up to five draft tweets.
Right.
And the staff member will write them in the way that they believe. So the message will be the same in each tweet, but there will be sort of different flourishes on each one.
Right.
And then Trump will get the memo and he'll look at it and he'll read all of them. And from there, he'll either circle one or decide,
hand it to him or do they send them? They hand it to him on a piece of paper. Oh, God.
So it's on a piece of paper.
Yeah.
And then he'll either select one or else he'll lightly edit one and send that one to be.
Wasn't there one recently, and hope I was right, that he spelled Melania wrong?
Yeah.
Who wrote that one?
Yes. And nobody is fessing up to that one.
Melanie.
The dog, if he had a dog, that would be blamed on the dog.
Fascinating. Thank you, yes. Annie Lenski.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
When we come back, breaking news, Democrat Stacey Abrams wins her party's nomination in Georgia's gubernatorial primary tonight, becoming the first black woman in the country to win a major party's nomination for governor. But does she have a shot at winning it all? Democrat Stacey Abrams wins her party's nomination in Georgia's gubernatorial primary. She is the first black woman in the country to win a major party's nomination for governor. GOP faces a runoff in July. And I want to bring in now CNN Politics senior writer and analyst Harry Enten. Harry, appreciate you joining us on this. Do you think a black female Democrat has a shot at the governorship in the heart of Trump country?
Well, I wouldn't say Georgia's necessarily in the heart of Trump country, but Stacey Abrams is certainly an underdog. No Democrat has won the governorship in Georgia since 1998. That's 20 years ago. And obviously, Donald Trump carried that state 2 years ago by a 5 percentage point margin. So Abrams is an underdog, but she certainly has a shot at winning this.
Yeah. So Democrats had high hopes in Georgia's 6th district. Earlier in the Trump presidency, and those hopes were dashed, really. Has the political landscape changed since then?
Well, it certainly changed a little bit over the course of 2017 and became more Democratic, but we've obviously seen in the generic ballot more recently that it's again shifted a bit more Republican. And I should point out that Georgia 6 was emblematic of special elections we've seen on the state legislative level as well in Georgia, whereby Democrats have not really been outperforming the baseline as said in the 2016 presidential election.
Yeah. So, I mean, that larger the larger landscape, both in Georgia and nationwide in 2018, let's talk about that, because it's looking like this blue wave might not be such a wave or a tsunami after all.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at the generic congressional ballot, which traditionally has been a pretty good guide of the national environment, what you see is that the Republican Party has made a bit of a comeback. Now, the Democrats are still ahead. But instead of being ahead by double digits, they're ahead more like by mid-single digits. And that points to a very close race for the House of Representatives in the fall if it holds.
Harry, thank you. I appreciate that. Let's bring in now political commentator Scott Jennings, Simone Sanders, and Kevin Madden. Hello to all of
Greetings.
You.
Greetings.
What do you think? What do you think of her chances, Simone? A black woman in the South, in Georgia, and it's still Trump country. He says it's not the heart of Trump country, but he won.
It's over there. It's definitely
there.
Georgia's definitely in Trump
it's in the neighborhood,
I would say.
Yeah.
It is in the neighborhood. It's in the hood, as we'd like to say. Look, I think Stacey Abrams definitely has a chance. What she did in this primary election is she went out there and people criticized her for spending money early, but what she did is she put that money on doors and folks to knock those doors and a very heavy field program where she had more touches in almost in every single county in Georgia than her Democratic opponent. I think we're going to see her do some of the similar things in the general election. And the question is all about turnout. I think Stacey Abrams has a message that speaks to a wide swath of people in Georgia. The question is, will they come out?
Is that similar to what Doug Jones did, you think, in a way, to reach out to Doug Jones sort of reach out to more Democrats than...
Right, and tried to play more in the suburbs. I still think, though, that Stacey Abrams is a bit of a long shot. I think this is still a pretty safe seat. The demographics of those suburbs around for Atlanta, for example, I think they're changing. The question is, are they changing fast enough?
Right.
Democrats were very bullish on Michelle Nunn, for example, in 2014 for her chances. She ended up losing to now Senator Perdue by about 10 points. So this is kind of like that old joke about Lucy holding the football for Charlie Brown. Georgia has been one of those states where Democrats say this is a swing state, it's going to change, it's going to turn blue. We've just yet to see it really come to fruition.
What do you think, Mr. Jennings?
Good ground game in a low turnout election obviously allowed her to roll up a really big margin. I still think I'm with Kevin on this. It's a bit of a long shot, although Georgia is one of those Sun Belt states that demographically is changing. You see there's a large swath of states along that, Sun Belt part of the United States that have been really red, but you could see in the future could be more problematic for the Republican Party if they don't do better with Hispanics and younger voters. So I think that Republicans are likely to hold here. But certainly it's an attention-attracting race because of the, really, she won by a huge margin.
Yeah, a huge margin. I mean,
are they turning purple, those states, or lavender? I mean, they're getting close, right?
Yeah, that's definitely a trending purple area.
Yeah. Okay, so listen, I want to talk about things looking better for Republicans nationally because I asked Mr. Inton that earlier. What happened, Kevin, to that blue wave that was supposed to come?
Well, I think a lot of Republicans are coming home. Some of them are coming home on some of the hot button issues like immigration. That has been an issue that we've been talking about. It's been in the focus of public policy debates around the country. I think that buoys some Republicans. I think the economic optimism that you see right now has Republicans and many, even independents and some voters in some of these swing areas trending more towards Republicans. But I think the greatest gift that we have is that Democrats have yet to figure out a very coherent economic message to a lot of those voters that may be disaffected by some.
And the economy's doing well now, so.
Right. And if you track it, some of this economic optimism with the generic ballot, it tracks pretty closely.
And I remember having the Democrats on the panel earlier when it was high, like, oh, the Democrats is going to be a blue wave. Do you think? And everyone said, slow your roll. It's early. Like Kevin said, Republicans usually come home.
Ask me in May, they said.
Right.
It's now May.
Right, so it's now May. So do you think that, folks should stop, Democrats should stop talking about this wave and just wait and see or get a message together, like Kevin said?
Well, so I don't agree that the Democrats don't necessarily have a message. We've seen House Democrats come out with this. Now, people have been critical of it, the better deal. But I will say that House Democrats are going out there
that reaction? Can you do that again?
Please save us from this hellish economy where unemployment is lower than 4%.
But what Democrats are saying in these House districts is saying, look, a better deal for you means X. And Republicans, when they had a chance, they did. Yes, they passed a tax bill where you were seeing short-term returns. But in the long run, it's corporations that have permanent tax cuts that see big, 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 big paybacks, and the little guys don't. And so that's what Democrats are talking about. I'd like to note that everything that I've seen sees a lot of these vulnerable Republicans are not running on that tax bill, Scott. So Democrats are talking about the economy. The problem is, we spend a lot of time when folks turn on the television, we're not talking about the economy. We're talking about Stormy Daniels. We're talking about Russia. We're talking about all these things that I think are, also important for us to talk about. But the voters, they don't want to talk about Russia.
Yeah, but remember what happened when the news focused on the Monica Lewinsky scandal, right? Bill Clinton's numbers went up.
Yeah. So that is why Democrats are not out here running on Russia. They are talking about health care. They're talking about the economy. Yeah. They're talking about holding this president accountable.
Scott's loving this. You should see his reaction.
I still think Democrats have a really good chance. But the problem here is that you've got, I saw an article in Politico the other day. Did you read that about the shadow organization, Super PAC, on the right that has that's putting $71 million in a ground game, sending folks directly to people's houses, telling them about what the Republicans have been doing for them. Yeah. We don't have that kind of money on the left, so we got to do some real tough work to make up some ground.
I want to play this, and I played it last time. This is Leslie Stahl sharing a conversation that she had with the president back in 2016, and she said, we don't have it. Okay, well, anyway, back in 2016, she asked him why he kept attacking the media, and he said, because I want the stories that they report about me. I don't want people to believe them. Basically, he admitted that he does why he does it. Not that the news is fake. He just doesn't want people to believe it. Does that bother you?
I mean, I think it's pretty consistent with what most politicians who don't like negative stories try to do. I mean, they don't want people to believe negative stories. I don't think I've ever worked for a politician who wanted people to believe the negative stories. I'm a little surprised that he said it in as candid terms as he did. But it's no big surprise as that's why you would do it. I do think that he has gotten some unfair shakes at times. I'll tell you, it happened recently. I thought he got a real unfair shake on the whole comment about MS-13. That was a recent example of, I think, what he's talking about, which is you guys try to make
about MS-13.
He said in the meeting, gang members are animals.
But that's not what he says, Scott.
It is what he said.
He didn't say that MS-13 gang members are animals. He said these people are animals directly after talking about, after the sheriff mentioned MS-13.
Okay, got it. That is the first time. That is the first time we talked about it on this program because we didn't report it because it was not in context. Just so you know. So everyone is not reporting that.
Well, but
I think they're hyping that up a bit.
But that is an example, I think, of Republicans see the way the press sometimes treats a president. Okay. I think that's why he reacts the way he does.
I want to talk to you guys about, I have a bit of breaking news here. It says Scott Jennings' wedding anniversary is tonight. It's his 14th. And I'm supposed to give his wife a shout-out for letting him come on. What's your wife's name again?
What a romantic guy,
your wife is a saint.
Autumn Jennings.
Can you look right there and say?
Autumn Jennings, hello. Happy anniversary. We've been married 14 years. We got married during the 2004 Bush campaign, which Kevin and I both worked on.
Just say happy anniversary.
And I did a conference call. I did a Bush campaign conference call from the church rectory.
Okay. She's waiting on you to look in the camera and say, happy anniversary, honey.
Happy
I love you.
Happy anniversary. I love you. I hope the kids are in bed.
Boy, some people. Congratulations. Happy anniversary. Thank you all. We'll be right back. On federal land in Alaska, some hunters may be happy, but many think the changes are not fair game. CNN's Dan Simon has a story.
If you're a big game hunter, there may be no better spot than Alaska. Bears, wolves, and caribou among the many majestic animals that are part of the state's natural habitat. 3 years ago, the Obama administration made hunting them more difficult on federal land. But under President Trump and his Interior Secretary Ryan Zinke, an avid hunter himself, a striking reversal. The National Park Service issuing a notice that it wants to roll back regulations for sport hunting in Alaska's national preserves. Trophy hunting could get a lot easier. And that has conservation groups outraged.
Trump has just been pushing time and time again to open up additional opportunities to kill big game like wolves, bears, here in the United States and abroad.
Among the changes, bait hunting would be okay again. Foods like bacon and donuts previously outlawed would be fair game to lure and shoot brown bears. Wolves and their pups could also be killed in their dens, while motorboats could be used to shoot swimming caribou. High-powered lights would also be okay to allow hunters to better see their prey. Critics like Colette Adkins note that President Trump's sons are avid trophy hunters and believe it may have been a factor in the decision.
Killing mother bears and their cubs near dens using artificial lights, that's not sporting. That's not fair chase. That's really blood sport.
But in Alaska, where big game hunting is embedded in the state's culture, state wildlife officials are pleased with the decision because the federal rules would become more consistent with state rules. Rural communities in particular don't want to be told by the feds how to do their hunting. As for using donuts and bacon as bait,
it is a method of taking bears that is legal in Alaska and in fact legal in many states. And it's generally done in very rural places. It is a legal method of taking of bears.
In a statement, the Alaska Department of Fish and Game says the state's goal as primary wildlife manager on all lands within its borders will be to CNN San Francisco.
All right, Dan, thank you very much. When we come back, Jeff Corwin joins me. I'm going to ask him what he thinks about the Trump administration rolling back protections for wildlife. Trump administration wants to end an Obama-era ban on hunting practices that some people say are cruel. Listen to some of the things they want to allow. Using food like bacon and donuts to lure and shoot bears. Killing wolves and their pups right in their dens. And using high-powered lights so hunters can better see their prey. Is this fair game? Well, let's discuss all of this now with wildlife biologist Jeff Corwin. Jeff, I appreciate you joining us. Good evening to you. How common are these kinds of practices among hunters?
Well, Don, we're talking about national preserves, which are managed by the National Park Service. These are the most prestigious, most celebrated landscapes on our planet, especially when it comes to symbols of who we are as a country. So the idea that you would allow techniques of this sort to hunt in landscape and wildlife that belongs to all of us is absolutely absurd and demoralizing and incredibly depressing.
So what about the fact that these are, you said, land that belongs to all of us? These are public lands, granted at times very remote, but where other people come to enjoy recreation and wildlife. Should that be a factor here?
Well, absolutely. These are the symbols of who we are as a nation. For example, many states allow for hunting and fishing. I'm a hunter and fisherman myself. I love to connect with the outdoors and natural resources, in addition to my work as a wildlife biologist. And each state, Don, has its own regulations in how it manages wildlife. But federally and nationally, we go through the Department of the Interior and the National Park Service and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service that primarily use data and science as the backdrop to putting forth regulations when it comes to connecting with resources. For example, if you're in Yellowstone National Park, you need to fish with a barbless hook. And we're talking about killing pups and bear cubs and wolf babies and taking ungulates down from boats and rivers. It's incredibly unheard of. But unfortunately, Don, it's really not surprising. There has never been a presidential administration more willfully intent on being negligent when it comes to managing our resources than this administration. Look at their stance on climate change denial, the shrinking of national monuments, the absurd border wall through Mexico and the United States and all these protected habitats, the importation of elephant and lion trophies. This is just one more crack
in the dam that ultimately... I'll talk to you a little bit more about that, but just to be clear, don't a lot of people hunt this way?
Do a lot of people hunt this way?
Yeah.
In what way? Very rarely have I ever heard of states allowing people to spot hunt wildlife. In fact, most states, including my state, Massachusetts, okay, it is illegal to use spotlights to hunt animals. You don't kill the offspring, their future generation of a species survival.
So listen, you mentioned it, you talked about the Trump administration. It's not the first time that they have rolled back protections on wildlife and land. They're also allowing imports of trophies derived from big game hunting, which you talked about, on a case-by-case basis, drastically reduced parkland surrounding two national monuments in Utah. What do you think the motivation is for rolling back these regulations, Jeff?
I believe it's a willful and purposeful negligence when it comes to managing our resources. I think this is what happens when you allow big business to secure the director of the EPA, Scott Pruitt, and when you allow the president's son, who is a big game hunter in Africa, to select the director of the Department of the Interior, Secretary Zinke. This is what you get. And elections have consequences, Don, and the consequences here are devastating when it comes to the future of our natural resources. Again, it's not about accessing resources and using resources. It's about being pragmatic, wise, and sustainable. And I see none of that here. And in the end, Don, I think it's my children that are going to pay the price. We know for a fact that there are species on the brink of extinction. We know for a fact that a species and race of rhino just tipped into the extinction threshold with the passing of the only surviving male. Yet this administration is opening up the importation of trophies from countries that have proven themselves to be unstable when it comes to wildlife management. So unfortunately, it is depressing and it is shocking, but it kind of goes with the territory.
I wonder if, you know, speaking about the sons, you mentioned his sons, Don Jr. and Eric, avid hunters. But the president has at times expressed distaste for their trophy hunting. What impact do you think the publicity over this rule change will have, if any?
Don, I think there's just so much embarrassment of riches on the radar screen, that this will just kind of blip and disappear. As with the whole allowing the importation on a case-by-case basis when it comes to trophy hunting. And again, for me, it's not about an access to resources or hunting or fishing. It's saying that a country like Zimbabwe that had a dictator who was served roasted baby elephant on his 90th birthday, to say that this country is in a stable place with the checks and balances that we traditionally have in our country when it comes to resource use, I mean, that's preposterous. But this is kind of how this administration plays. We know that President Trump has said in the past that he found this distasteful. And what happened? We were focused on other things, Don, and they came in and they slid this under the door. And now this is just one more example of how our country today is being steered down a path of potentially no return when it comes to the protection of our species. When science doesn't matter, Don, when we deny climate change with regard to a changing planet, this, I mean, this is just the frosting on the cake.
Yeah. Jeff Korn, we're out of time. Thank you so much. I appreciate the time we've had together. Thank you.
Thanks, Don.
That's it for us tonight. Thanks.